Dogumentary TV, producing the best breed documentaries on YouTube.
My name is Gustar Barrow, and I work for a large Fortune 500 company. I'm a logistics manager. I've been there for approximately 18 years. Went to USC, got two daughters and a wife, and that's about it for me. You know, I'm a dog guy. My dog's name is Jao, which is Portuguese for John. So people call him John, Jao. My wife calls him JJ. He's about maybe 33 inches of withers, maybe about 175 pounds. Chow is approximately 3.5 years old. Funny story, you know, I lived in California for approximately 20 odd years. And a couple years ago, I had a Tibetan Mastiff named Malachi. And there's a famous singer by the name of Aaron Hall. He used to pass in front of my house walking his dog. And one day, he just rapped on the door. He said, "Hey, man, do you have a dog back there?" I said, "Well, why you want to know?" He says, "Well, every time my dog passes here, he just shrivels up. There's got to be a dog back there." I said, "Yeah, I got a Tibetan Mastiff." He said, "Bring him out." I'm like, "No, I'm not going to bring him out." So long story short, we kind of became friends, you know, and he would come by constantly. We started kind of hanging out together a little bit. And one day, he called me. And he said, "Hey, I know we've been talking a lot about dogs, and you told me about a story about your dad owning a Fila back in the day. And do you want a Fila?" I'm like, "Yeah, that's ultimately, you know, my holy grail of dogs, right?" Go over to his house. He shows me this white-looking puppy. I said, "What is wrong with you? This is not a Fila. This is just a white, you know, maybe a lab mixed with something." And I left. Well, maybe 2 weeks later, he calls me. He says, "You know, I was just testing you. I got a feeler for you. Come back over." I went back over, and there was the puppy, Chow. He was maybe about 3 months old, kind of a little skinny, but, you know, had a lot of life to him. He gave me the dog free of charge. I mean, I took him home. The wife, kids loved him. However, it was the devil's own job trying to get the dog to eat. You know, I had to get up in the middle of the night, try to feed him. And I guess he was at that stage where he was starting to bond with Aaron, right? So ultimately, he kind of bonded with us, started eating, and that's the 175-pound guy that I have right now. Originally, I'm from Guyana, and a little small, tiny village on the west coast of the Atlantic. It's called Stuartville. Actually, I just came back from there about a week ago. I went to visit my mom. My mom is 95 years old, still lives down there. But yeah, little tiny town, do a lot of fishing there. Folks hunt there, that kind of stuff. So like, that's my origins. My dad kind of had a business and actually worked away from the house, like about 60 miles in a place called Linden. And that's a mining town. And they had a lot of hunting and stuff that went on there. So my dad had these dogs, and one dog, and he had another dog, which was like a mutt. But the Fila was primarily for hunting. We would go out almost every Friday afternoon. My dad come pick me up from high school, jump in he had a Land Cruiser, and we would go up to a place called Oriala in Guyana. And we were there all weekend. I think one of the things that got me, you know, so enamored by Filas was one trip that we took up there. My dad kind of went off, and I was kind of like standing next to a tree. I didn't notice that there was a wild boar like a couple paces away from me. I didn't see the boar. All of a sudden, here comes Duke just flying through the bush and attacked the boar. You know, the thing could have charged me. I don't know. My back was towards it. So from that day, I kind of had this, you know, affinity for these kind of dogs, this Fila dog. And you know what? To a T, John is exactly what I want. You know, it's a utility dog. You could do anything with him. I take him to the beach. I take him hiking. He's in the house. If I'm reading a book, he has his paw on my foot. You know, he's like one of them kind of Velcro guys. But I know if any situation jumps off, this guy's going to handle business. I know it for a fact, you know. If someone drives up in front of my house, I know they're there long before, because either he growls, his body language changes. They're very sensitive dogs, you know, they pick up things pretty quick. My understanding of it was this dog was a fabrication of a bunch of dogs, right? In Brazil, they started putting together a bunch of big Fila muscular type dogs, and the one thing that the dog was supposed to do was supposed to hunt down runaway slaves, right? You get away, this dog was gonna find you. And you could see it from their lung capacity, the way they move. They're very, you know, sleek, they're agile, they could run for days. I mean, they don't run fast. However, they will keep up with you. They don't stop. And so that's my understanding of it. You know, these guys started to breed them, and it was ultimately the English Mastiff and a couple other big dogs that they used, and they got this Fila dog. I think the Bloodhound was in there also, so that's my understanding of it. Ultimately, the one word to describe a Fila is sharp. You know, they're sharp intelligently, they get hot quick, they are not gonna take any nonsense, they get between their, and the body language is always about guarding, right? If he's in the truck, he's gonna protect the truck. If he's home, he's gonna protect the home. If I'm walking with him, somebody comes up and they don't look right, or the Fila senses something, they get between you. And so sharp is a word that I always try to pin on my dogs, because they are going to get in the mix of stuff and, you know, handle business. And they're very intelligent dogs too, you know, you see them all the time. In the back of my yard, I got a couple of tangerine trees, right? And they're more likely for the squirrels. They're always there to eat, they make a bunch of noise. And every once in a while, I see John go up there and he would look at them. And he's looking at them. Lo and behold, I'm sitting, the way my house is situated, you could look out the back, there's some French doors, and you could actually see the tree. And I look out, and there he is, he has one of them in his mouth. I don't know how he got this thing, maybe he came down too low, but he caught one of them and killed him, you know? So that's the kind of stuff that they do. I think they're stealth. You would be in the house and really not know he's there, even though he's such a big dog, you know, they lie down. As long as he has his paw on you, or he knows he's sleeping, he's napping, that kind of stuff, yeah, that's what they do. I am, you know, I have had Mastiffs all my life. I can't remember, I think one time in my life I had a pit bull. And since I started feeding raw, I expect 13 years for my dogs. Just my expectation, I'll do everything to get them to 13. Malachi, which was a Tibetan Mastiff, he was 13 years old when I put him down. And, you know, so I'm looking forward about 13 years for my dog. And that goes with exercise and feeding and the way I treat him. I take him to the vet, all that stuff. So bloat is a big factor. That's the one thing that really, the couple of folks that I know that have them, I know a guy in the valley that had two of them. He lost one from bloat. And ultimately, if you're going to feed them kibble, you got to feed them slow. You know, I prefer to feed my dogs raw. I've always fed my dogs raw. And I believe the energy that they have to expel to eat the raw food actually helps them not to get bloat. Because if they eat fast, just gobble stuff down, like the kibble, they just gobble that stuff down, there comes the bloat, dog is dead. But you give them like a half a chicken or a leg of venison or something like that, they sit down there, they gotta work. That stuff is not going away. And I don't chop it up. I give him if I'm giving him a leg, he has the leg. He deal with it all best he can. Try not to have it frozen. But you could see, it's like, if you watch any kind of nature show, National Geographic shows or stuff like that, you see lions, and when they kill something, it's days. That's not a quick meal. You know, I think it's the same thing holds true for dogs of this size, and to kind of alleviate that bloat factor. So I feed them raw. My dogs love vegetables, carrots, grapes, that kind of stuff I give them. Jawa's got an affinity for tangerines. You know, he got it back there. So he eats a bunch of tangerines and stuff like that. But, you know, no health issues other than that. I know because it's a big dog, you get hip dysplasia. So those kind of things. But they're pretty solid. They're a very hardy dog, man. You know, every once in a while, maybe an eye infection. So you got to be careful because they have that kind of funny looking eye. So make sure that nothing gets in there and that kind of stuff. When I lived in Tarzana, before, when I had the pit, My wife called me one evening. I work in the evenings primarily, right? And my wife said, hey, there's a guy in the backyard. It's like, what do you mean there's a guy in the backyard? She said, somebody jumped a fencer in the backyard. I'm like, just, you know, the pit's name was Mauser. I said, just let Mauser out. So Mauser goes out there. Mauser becomes friends with the guy. Right? I told my wife, I said, you know what? Just stay in the house. I'll come home. The guy was kind of a little mentally unstable or something. I came home. I talked to him. He was calm. I let him out the backyard, and he took off. The backyard was, there was an alley back there, so that's where he got in from. After that incident, I said, you know what? I need to have some kind of protection, because sometimes I'm not home until 12 at night. I got my wife, kids at home alone. So I met Lewis Williams down in LA. He is the owner of Black Mass Canine. And I actually took that pit down there to get him trained. Long story short, Lewis assessed the dog. We started training. He said, look, Gus, this dog is not a working line dog. This dog is somebody's friend. It's always going to be somebody's friend. You can't want to make him something else, right? So I kind of got rid of that dog, and I ended up with the Tibetan Mastiff, Malachi. He was at Lewis, I guess. The guy who was training him had to transfer, something like that. I bought that dog off of Lewis, and we started working with him. And I kind of see, you know, the control you have over the dog after you do protection training. I'm not a harsh guy. I don't want my dogs to be, you know, everything I say you gotta do kind of thing, but I want when I call them to come, they come, and I said to sit, lay down, stay there, those kind of things, basic commands. And then I started introducing some protection work, and Malachi just loved that stuff. It was like just natural to him. I remember we did a couple of rag work, and Lewis is like, this dog is way advanced for rag work. Let's put him on a sleeve. And, you know, he's one of those dogs. He bites you, likes to twist you up and stuff like that with that kind of weight. So that's why I got into it. But ultimately, it's for protection of my wife, my kids, my property, that kind of stuff. We normally go down to LA on Sundays. I spend almost the whole day down there, and we do it that way. But obedience-wise, I think every day we walk. We do a lot of hiking together in the trails and stuff like that over there. We do that almost every day. I leave home like at 6 in the morning, take him. We go over there. I'm back by 8:15. So on those walks, I try to introduce some obedience stuff, you know, just trying to keep him sharp. With these big dogs, everything is on the dog schedule. Right, so just realize that. If you decide to get, people out there, if you decide to get a Mastiff of any kind or any one of these Velcro dogs, they make the choice. You can't force that on them. But I always said, nobody runs from good. So if you treat your dog good, I mean, and that definition could be broad. I'm talking about taking care of them, you know, when you come home, you greet your dog. I'm like, Jao, I mean, he always gives me a high five. I don't know, he developed that, you know. One time, actually, Aaron showed me, said, hey, this dog likes to shake hand. I'm like, what is he talking about? Lo and behold, Jao is a high five dog. I come in the house, I say, hey, Jao, how are you doing? He sits down, bam, he gives you a high five. And that's the bond you get. And it's with my kids, it's with my wife, it's just that kind of bond you. And it, ultimately, I think it happens because the dog feels comfortable with you. The dog feels taken care of. The dog feels loved. I mean, those kind of things are the same expression that everybody, a human, looks for, right? You get in a relationship with a man or a woman, you're looking for love, right? It's the same thing with a dog. If you start treating your dog bad, I don't think there's a bond, because ultimately people tend to move away from bad treatment. I don't care who you are, you know. So that bond relationship comes about because of how you treat your dog. John in the house, if you were a fly on the wall, you would think it's a lap dog. I mean, he loves to be around my wife. My wife is cooking. He's right there. One of the training that I do is when I put him down, I always try to step over him. Because a lot of people get injured that way, right? You try to step over a dog, the dog gets up. You fall, you hit the back of your head or something, you get a concussion. So my training is I put him down and I step over him because that's the way he is in the house. He's always around, either he's down or whatever. My wife is cooking the kids. And that's the gentleness that you see. They love to snore. You hear them snoring, you think somebody's cutting down a bunch of timber in the Amazon or something, right? So that's the kind of the flip side to that is, I have seen him violent. When they bite you, they just don't bite you. They kind of use their entire body. Pounds per square inch pressure is tremendous. So that's the viciousness. That's the vicious side of the dog. You know, it's going to hurt you if you are not, if you have any kind of negative intentions towards me or my family, they pick that stuff up and they get involved and they're going to make, most times I call them an independent contractor because when they get into that zone, most times you can't necessarily control them because they're going to protect you for, you know, till they're dead. You know, one of the things I do with the protection training, the big thing for me is outing, you know, trying to emphasize outing. I don't necessarily care about the bites, but I'm care about the outing. Be able to say, hey, out, get rid of the sleeve. And Jao's pretty good at that, but I know for a fact that if he gets into a scrimmage or something with somebody, it's going to be bad. They're strong dogs. They're very strong dogs, man. Yeah, well, you know, most insurance companies don't even give you a policy for these kind of dogs, right? You know, you got to be financially secure to make sure you take care of anything. I mean, you as an owner of a Fila, the first thing you got to get in your head is, look, this dog is not a pet. You may think, and there are times you may even believe he's pet-like because of the way he operates in the house, the way he operates around your family, but please don't get it twisted and think that, oh yeah, I'm gonna let anybody come in the house whenever. Watch for the body language of the dogs. These dogs tend to raise their tail up, you know, get into that aggressive position. You as an owner, you gotta see those things before they happen. So always got locks on your gate, have an 8-foot wall, try to make it as private as possible. Don't give anybody the opportunity to come into your yard any willy-nilly way. I mean, my gardener's been with us for 2+ years. Every time he comes over, I told him, I said, the one thing I want you to do is tell me the day you want to come. You know, Thursday, fine. What time? 12 to 1. Well, 12 to 1, Jai is gonna be in the house. I always tell my wife, I said, please don't think you could, you know, take him for a walk. He might walk with you, but somebody may look at you wrong. He takes that the wrong way. Boom. There's an incident, right? So you try to instill that. They're good with the family, but ultimately they're not a pet dog. They are a working line dog that needs to be controlled. Jao is not aggressive towards animals. I see him sniff out of dogs. There's a dog that comes over to the house all the time and hangs out. He comes in there. They play all the time. I've seen him play and forget to eat. Just keep playing, you know, there's the raw food on the ground and he's just running around all day. So I've never seen any kind of dog aggression. I know for a fact that I've seen him kind of push the other dog away from my wife. You know, like the dog kind of getting close and he thought maybe he was getting some affection or whatever. He just came right in there, used his body and said, you know, move away kind of deal. So, but to attack another dog, no. Also on the walks that we do in the morning, I met a guy on the walks, his name is Jay, and he has his two small chihuahuas, I think they are. And I think one is maybe a papillon or something like that. Those are his buddies. Actually, Jay has a funny picture of Jao walking and JJ is just right under the dog, like sheltering, you know. That was a kind of neat picture, you know. Yeah, but I never seen any kind of aggression towards other animals at all. As I said, they are utility dogs. If you give a dog a tax job, I know he's gonna fight. I know that for a fact. You know, he's not gonna shy away from a fight. You could see that in his body language. When he approaches other dogs, it's not in a cowering way. It's always, you know what, I'm in charge kind of thing here, but I'm big enough to know that I don't need to do anything to you. But that doesn't mean that, you know, you could start something and I'm not gonna get going, you know. I think The one thing I look for in a dog, and I found it in Jao, was the mutual bond that we have, right? I do a lot of outdoorsy thing. Jao was never back down from any of them. Salt water, sweet water. We go up in the mountains. I go on the roof to do like clean out the gutters, and he's right there watching me. Like, yeah, you need my help, kind of deal. That's the kind of dog, you know. Always greets me. I could come home, and the way my house is set up, he could open the garage. I open the garage. The cars are not in the garage. They're always outside. He comes out. If I got groceries, whatever, he's right there. You know, the one thing you got to watch with these kind of dogs, too, you get a lot of slobber. They're big dogs, right? But I love him because of his utility aspect of him. He could do anything. Anything. He's one of those kind of dogs. You know, some dogs are capable of just doing, you know, guard work, protection work, and they're always sharp. They're not nice towards the family and that kind of stuff. Chow is the total opposite. You know, he's being in the house. My wife is cooking. She got a piece of carrot. She throws it. He catches it. You know, plays with her, plays with the kids. I could not ask for a better dog. I mean, I love him. My childhood kind of led me to the dog, but ultimately, as a man now, I'm making my own kind of memories with my dog, right? That was my dad's dog. That was a family dog. But Jao was kind of almost, in some sense, it's like the glue of our family. You know, everybody has a relationship with the dog. But, you know, ultimately, he is like kind of the head honcho in the house. You know, everybody comes, hey, how is Jao? Everybody calls my brothers, and I'm from a large family. More than likely, first thing they say, hey, how's the big guy? And I know it's Jao they're talking about, you know. People always say, hey, could I pet him? And I tell them, look, just say hi from afar, you know, and that's the best thing. Yesterday, I told my daughter I was going to be doing this, and she's like, you better make sure they don't make Jao look stupid. It's like, you know, because long story short, she looks out for the dog, you know. Yeah, he's a good guy. He's a good dog.